May the peace of Christ be with you. Let's try that again. I know there are very few of us this morning, but something tells me it can be a bit louder. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
There we go. That sounds great. Welcome to worship at the Stratum Community Church. Welcome to you if this is your first time worshiping with us. Welcome to you if you are worshiping with us all the time. Welcome to you if you are worshiping with us here in person, or if you are worshiping with us online. Welcome to you if you are gay or straight or somewhere in between. Welcome to you if you are of great faith or of no faith. Welcome to you no matter what. I am Reverend Wesley Kahn, pastor of this faithful church, a church deeply committed to building up the kingdom of God here in Stratum. We are worshiping together today thanks to the efforts and work of our deacons and church council who have created our reentry guidelines. I just want to highlight a few of those this morning. We ask that you keep your face coverings on throughout worship today. An offering plate is in the rear of the center aisle, and you can place your offering there as you enter or exit. You may also make your offering online using the QR code found in the announcement portion of our bulletin. For now, only the choir will be singing our hymns. This is a hard ask for us singing folk, so we appreciate your understanding for now. Today we will be celebrating communion, and during the celebration, you will be invited to come forward by pew, by one of our deacons. When you come forward, we ask you to do so spaciously and take a packet of communion, which has both elements, the bread and the juice, and then return to your pew using the outer aisle. And once everyone has had a chance to receive the elements and return to their seats, we will take of the Lord's Supper together. The deacons are meeting monthly to reassess these guidelines, and they will do so this Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. So until then, we continue to ask for your patience and your prayers as we emerge from this pandemic. Are there any other announcements at this time? Seeing none, let us enter into our time of worship, preparing our hearts and minds as we let the music of the prelude wash over us.
One more. of your days from your feet. We are standing on holy ground.
Our teacher, the source of love and light, is among us. Speak, Lord, your people are listening.
We will now have the singing of the hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, offered by the choir.
Thank you.
God appeared to Ezekiel, and he fell on his face. He fell on his face. We don't know if this is because of sheer amazement, astonishment, or reverence. The Bible doesn't say. But the Bible does say that God lifted Ezekiel back onto his feet by filling him with the Spirit so that God could speak. To be a prophet means to be a speaker on behalf of God, to speak to the people as God's messenger. This seems straightforward, but when the people are described as, now these are the Bible's words, not mine, when the people are described as impudent, stubborn, and a rebellious house, being a prophet takes on a different tone. Ezekiel's prophecies throughout the book, they involve ghastly visions, dangerous messages, and wild trances. The metaphors and imagery he uses in his prophecies are downright offensive. And perhaps this is why Jewish traditions restricted the book's reading, and why, as Christians, we only read bits and pieces of it in our public worship. Ezekiel's overall message to God's people was back then, and is now, generally unwelcomed. His message is of human unfaithfulness in the face of God's unending love. Human unfaithfulness in the face of God's unending love. Now, from his visions, Ezekiel spoke of the evils of idolatry, how the worship of anything or anyone other than God would lead to destruction. God, Ezekiel further declared, remained unbought and incapable of manipulation. God's favor, however, demanded faithfulness. Thou shalt not have no other God before me, says the Lord. Now, these particular words that are so familiar to us might be a bit cute and comforting. That is, until they start to take aim at our power, our prestige, politics. In Mark's gospel that we heard read today, Jesus is in his hometown synagogue, where he is teaching on the Sabbath. We aren't told what he's teaching, but whatever it is, it does not go over well. One might suspect being in one's hometown would lend itself to a welcoming crowd, but that just is not the case for Jesus. Jesus is berated and lambasted. He is mocked for being born under illegitimate circumstances. And in a display of classism, his words and wit are rejected for being blue-collar, because Mark says he is a carpenter. He is associated with personalities that we are led to believe who are unfaithful, his own brothers and sisters. In his hometown, Jesus and his message is flat-out rejected. Now, Mark's gospel doesn't tell us what Jesus was preaching in his synagogue, but we can surmise that his message is not all that dissimilar from the parables he taught around the Sea of Galilee. And his teachings were probably not unlike the healings that he performed for those down and out. We know that Jesus, wherever he went, his message had to do with the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is a kingdom built on love. A love that resists power and control. A love that is like a weed that will spread everywhere and grow so tall that the birds of the air can nest in it. A love that moves mountains, a love that shines. It's a love that can't be sidelined or boxed in or contained. It's a love that knows no bounds. Sometimes, Jesus' teaching about love makes for warm platitudes and fuzzy feelings. But then, that same love puts demands on our loyalties, our lives, and our livelihoods. Both of these stories today about Ezekiel and Jesus, both of these people are rejected. Their words of God's kingdom are unwanted. Preacher and professor Caroline Lewis, she suggests that rejection of any kind is symptomatic of a larger issue. She says that in the case of resistance to God's love and faithfulness, here, she says it is idolatry. God's love and faithfulness, when taken seriously, are a hard message to hear. Because the truth of God's love and faithfulness means that God doesn't like or dislike the same people that we do. God places people over policies, and to God, people are what matter. I'm beginning to see why there's some resistance to Ezekiel and Jesus. The message of God's kingdom is difficult. It upends the ways that we have structured our lives and our society. And any time that we place a line between ourselves and another, God's love goes on the other side. Now, even when we do our best, we often end up rejecting God's love. But here is the hardest part of this message. Even though we ignore Ezekiel, even though we toss Jesus out of the synagogue, God still loves us and is faithful to us. There is nothing that we can do or say to keep God from loving us. Now, God's love, it can't be earned, it can't be measured, it can't be based on merit. God's love is God's love, not ours. God's love is given to us freely. And God's message of faithfulness didn't end with Ezekiel. And if we know anything about Easter, we know that God's love didn't end with Jesus' rejection. Today, God's love comes to us here, here in this very space, at this very table. God's love never ceases. And God's love comes to us again and again, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. Take and drink. This is my blood." Let us receive God's love now in the singing of the hymn, "Guide My Feet." Thank you. There is no joy that does not come from God's hands, and there is no pain that does not echo in God's heart. Let us bring ourselves and our world into God in prayer. As we enter into a time of prayer, I invite anyone who has a prayer to lift up to do so now, and Lucy can provide a mic if you need. Seeing none, let us continue and be together as we lift up the prayers of our lives and our world. Gracious God, you send us prophets and apostles, preachers and teachers, so that we would know your love. You sent your very Son to dwell among us, loving us as you love us. Make your Holy Spirit to hold our prayers, those we speak and those we aren't ready to speak. Lord of love and light, we pray for the peoples and leaders of the world, that they may be reconciled one to another in pursuit of your justice and peace. God, you rule over all the nations. We bring before you this nation and all who live in it. In our celebration of freedom and unity this day, guide and direct us to a freedom that benefits all who live here. Make us to steward this land that shines from sea to shining sea. And give us wisdom to lead and to serve one another. We pray for other nations and other places, for your love and light is also upon them. Be especially with India and the countries throughout Africa as they suffer from another surge in the coronavirus. God, giver of our daily bread, we pray for all who go hungry and who have no home. We pray for all who suffer from prejudice, greed, or violence, that the heart of humanity may warm with your tenderness. We pray especially for all prisoners, for refugees, and for all who are oppressed. Son of God, in our need, you prepare a table before us. We pray for all in need. We pray for those suffering from famine, flood, and earthquake, that they would know the hope of your faithfulness through the help of others. Holy Spirit, our comfort in life and in death, and all the spaces in between, we pray for those who suffer the pain of sickness, loneliness, depression, and grief, and that those names on our hearts and on the hearts of others, or the names known only to you, may they receive strength and courage. We pray especially for the Tim Brown and Carrie O'Shea family. And Jesus, be near the Scammon family, Edward, Robin, Dottie, Jennifer, Nash, Trina, Pat, Cheryl, Sarah, and Sue. Living and loving God, we ask all these things in the name of your Christ, who with the Holy Spirit is among us still. Amen. The psalmist tells us to give God praise and to make known what God has done in our lives. How have you noticed God's love and work in your life? I invite you now to share a thankful dollar and make known God's work and love in your life.
Voices have been silent.
Beloved in Christ, the Gospel tells us that on the first day of the week, Jesus Christ was raised from death, appeared to Mary Magdalene, on that same day sat at table with two disciples, and was made known to them in the breaking of the bread.
This is the joyful feast of the people of God. Your people, Lord, come from the east and west, from the north to south, and gather at Christ's table.
This table is for all who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share in the community of God's people. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give God thanks and praise.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Please be seated. Let us pray. We give thanks, God of majesty and mercy, for calling forth the creation and raising us from dust by the breath of your being. We bless you for the beauty and bounty of the earth, and for the vision of the day when sharing by all will mean scarcity for none. We remember the covenant you made with your people Israel, and we give you thanks for all our ancestors in faith. We rejoice that you call us to reconciliation with you and all people everywhere, and that you remain faithful to your covenant, even when we are faithless. We rejoice that you call the entire human family to this table of sacrifice and victory. We come in remembrance and celebration of the gift of Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the good news. Born of Mary, our sister in faith, Christ lived among us to reveal the mystery of your word, to suffer and die on the cross for us, to be raised from death on the third day, and then to live in glory. We bless you, gracious God, for the presence of the Holy Spirit and the church you have gathered. With your people of faith in all times and places, we praise you with joy, responding together. Holy, holy, O holy God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory, O most powerful God. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God. Hosanna in the highest. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, and on the eve of death, Jesus gathered the disciples for the feast of the Passover. Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying,
"This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, also after supper, Jesus took the cup, filled it, and after giving thanks, gave it to them, saying,
"Drink this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Holy One, show forth among us the presence of your life-giving Word and Holy Spirit upon these gifts of bread and wine to sanctify us and your entire church through these holy mysteries. Grant that this communion may unite your people in heaven and on earth, nourishing our souls and bodies to accomplish your reign.
By whom and with whom and in unity, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be to you, eternal God, now and forever. Amen.
Let us continue our communion prayer with the Lord's Prayer, saying,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts,
bread which we break is the communion of the body of Christ. The cup of blessing which we bless is the communion of the blood of Christ. Behold what you are. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come now where all things are ready. This holy feast, bread of life, the cup of salvation, broken and shed for you. Having received the Lord's Supper, let us give thanks, praying together. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the gift of our Savior's presence and the simplicity and splendor of this holy meal. Unite us with all who are fed by Christ's body and blood, that we may faithfully proclaim the good news of your love, that your universal church may be a rainbow of hope in an uncertain world. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Let us receive now these ascending words from our choir as they sing the hymn, "This is My Song."
Thank you.
God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may God look upon you with kindness and give you peace.